Hello and welcome to the big picture. The poverty debate has once again begun, with the Rangarajan Committee set up by the UPA government last year submitting its report to the NDA government last week. People below poverty line has risen by nearly 100 million. This is in comparison to the Suresh Tendulkar Committee report submitted to the UPA government to the poverty figures in 2011 and 12. The Rangarajan Committee, meanwhile, has raised the poverty level to those who can spend rupees 32 per capita per day in rural areas and rupees 47 in urban areas. Again, up from Tendulkar's rupees 27 in rural areas and 33 rupees in urban areas. Controversy over the Tendulkar figures had erupted last year when then Deputy Chairman of Planning Commission Dr. Montek Singh Ahluwalia had endorsed the figures but had to later clarify that these figures would not be used for providing food under the Food Security Act. It was then that Rangarajan Committee had been set up to revisit the Tendulkar report. The question is, how relevant and important are these poverty figures? Do the methodology adopted stand scrutiny? The larger issue of has poverty been reduced in this country are all issues which are again on the board. Today we will discuss the Rangarajan report and all the issues associated with it with a panel of eminent guests. I have with me N.K. Singh, BJP leader and former MP and also former member of Planning Commission, as well as former Finance Secretary. Dr. Narendra Jadhav, former member of Planning Commission, Professor Praveen Jha of the Center for Economic Studies and Planning, JNU, and Vipul Mudgal, Project Director at the CSDS and also a senior journalist. Welcome to all of you. Mr. N.K. Singh, you're well aware of all these debates which have happened in the last few years about these poverty figures. Now the Rangarajan Committee has come out with this, with its own figures. How do you look at it?
Well, personally, I think it's more of the same, because going through the Rangarajan Committee report, he has by and large endorsed the methodology used by the Tendulkar Committee report. He has tweaked on some numbers.
Right.
He has tweaked because he is using a mixed recall period than the recall period method used, but it remains a consumption-based approach.
Right.
It is not an income-based approach.
Right.
And in the consumption-based approach, the weights which have been assigned is 43% for non-food items, 57% for the food items, and which is largely driven by the old poverty notion, namely that focus on the minimum calorific requirement of fat and protein,
right,
differentiated between the urban and rural category.
Right.
The problem really is that it has no relationship to any dynamic changes. It has no relationship to any indexation, because if in a certain sense you take nothing was changed and you only factor in the inflation which has taken place since Tendulkar had submitted, you would more or less get the kind of figures, if not a higher figure, than what Mr. Rangarajan has arrived at. The issue really is that all debates about poverty in this country mix up between four different components. First, I think that there is confusion what constitutes poverty.
Yeah.
How do you define poverty?
Absolutely.
This has escaped really any rigorous definition. Second, on poverty line, there are issues. Third, the issue of inequality and income inequality has got mixed up. And finally, since poverty numbers are related to entitlements, a lot of the poverty numbers are driven by what really are entitlements. In my view, you require a different approach, a different methodology. We need to move away from a consumption-based approach to an approach which the rest of the world has adopted, which Europe has adopted, which some of the other emerging markets have adopted, namely an incomes-based approach in which the poverty numbers are to be seen in a more dynamic context.
Okay. I think that you have put the discussion on the right track now. Dr. Narendra Jadhav, you have just been a member of the Planning Commission. You just, you just retired from there. You know what Mr. N.K. Singh says, there has been a long debate on this,
mm-hmm,
whether it should be consumption approach or income based approach, and he was talking of how the Rangarajan Committee is more or less of the same of what Tendulkar Committee is. But the fact of the matter is 100 million people, there is a difference of 100 million people,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
being below the poverty line or above the poverty line between the two, between Tendulkar and Rangarajan.
Right.
So my question is, going back to what Mr. Singh says, you think the income-based approach is the right approach?
Well, Perhaps income-based approach is the right approach, but I do not agree that with Mr. N.K. Singh on 3 points. It's not more of the same. There is a distinct difference between what was said by Tendulkar and what is now being said by Dr. Rangarajan. And you have given the number. The net result has been given. But in the methodology, there are 3 differences that I would like to point out.
Between
Tendulkar report and Dr. Rangarajan's report, which has just been released. First of all, the basis is not confined to calorie value alone.
Education and health.
You know, they have 3 different components now.
Right.
In fact, they have 1 component. Food component, of course, is there in terms of the nutritive value. But then they have added education, clothing, rent and conveyance. And then there is a 3rd component, that is the other non-food items. So they have generalized it much beyond what was done by Tendulkar, and that is why there is an incremental addition of 93 million people to the estimate that was given by Tendulkar earlier.
Okay,
that
so
is one.
Right.
Do you want me to respond?
No, yeah, please continue.
Yeah. Then there are other things that there was the issue raised that there is no dynamism there and there is no relation with indexation and only the inflation adjustment is done. This is completely wrong. What Rangarajan has done is for the same period, that is 2009-10 to 2011-12,
right.
But for the same period for which Tendulkar had given the report, that has been replicated. So there is no question of indexation. What has been done is that for the same period, if you generalize the methodology, taking into account several non-food items which were not accounted for earlier, what would be the result? That is the approach that Dr. Rangarajan has taken and explained it in a completely transparent manner. And I find it's not more of the same, but it is certainly an improvement over the Tendulkar committee report. However, I'm inclined to agree with him that probably overemphasis on consumption expenditure based approach should be eschewed in favor of an income based approach as it is done in several other countries.
Okay, Praveen? How do you blend the income based approach with the,
As you know, and everyone here is well versed with these issues and the relevant literature, the last 50 years, there's been a lot of discussion on how to define poverty, how to conceptualize poverty and so on. It's one of those things which probably is akin to, Hari Anant, Hari Katha Ananta, right? Now, basically, if you go by notions of relative poverty, then income poverty tends to come into picture much more strongly. Whereas, when you talk of absolute poverty, typically it is, much of the literature relies on consumption-based notions, right, etc. Of course, one can go beyond both income and consumption. One can talk of issues of dignity, various other kinds of deprivation and so on, which is what is being done, multidimensional deprivation, etc.
No, but as Dr. Jadhav pointed out, Rangarajan has expanded the parameters.
That is what I'm trying to, that is what is coming to, that certainly based on consumption as the foundation, Rangarajan committee is a significant advance over what we had earlier.
So it's not much of the same.
No, as certainly not.
As
certainly not. Basically, to put it very simply, it sort of goes by what it considers appropriate ICMR norms for calorie, protein, fats, right? And in addition to that, then what it does, it sort of looks at the median fractile, which is 45 to 50% for the 4 designated, already mentioned by Dr. Jadhav, expenses, that is clothing, rent, conveyance and education, right? And then it looks at the behavioral norms for which is linked with calorie fractile to work out the other non-basic needs,
right,
non-food basic needs, right? So it has given a certain sort of, let's say, set of criteria. Now, one can always debate whether it should be the 5th fractile or 6th fractile or 3rd fractile or whatever, right? All that can be debated, but certainly this is a significant advance given the fact that the kind of poverty which we have in our country, I mean, it's quite clear that even these figures, many would argue, are possibly not doing justice. Many would argue that maybe we should go back, or rather, maybe we should revisit the late Arjun Sen Gupta committee report and look at the figures there, which said poor and vulnerable and so on and so forth. So we have enough to choose from, but to say that this is simply more of the same probably is not quite appropriate. And you have something significant there.
Okay.
But how significant is that significant is the question that we can debate.
Yeah, we'll come to that. But Mr. Singh, before going to Vipul, Mr. Singh, would you like to react to what Dr. Jadhav and Praveen Jha have said?
Yes, I'd like to. I'd like to make two brief comments. First, I think that Mr. Jadhav misunderstood when I talked of inflation and indexation. I did not mean the fact that he is really taking the figures for a particular period and then compared it by using somewhat different norms. What I really meant is that in respect of assigning what the levels of expenditure which are needed for fulfilling these minimum inescapable needs, in the broad definition of poverty which he has done by adding many non-food items, and there is no attempt at a dynamic linkage to the changes in price dynamics, which would have added a new dimension in the definition of poverty. I mean, everybody knows, for instance, that inflation in the last 3 years, particularly in respect of food items, has been very, very sharp. And this is not, therefore, a report which can be adopted in perpetuity, which has no linkage to any changes in price levels. This is one broad. Second, certainly, I think it is an attempt at having a multi-dimensional poverty approach by bringing in some of the other elements. But the question is that good enough? Is that an approach which would really, as was pointed out by one of my co-panelists, able to give a minimum dignified life? Incidentally, the oldest definition of poverty, which I'm sure Narendra Jadhav would recall, was the definition given at the time of our independence movement by Dadaji Nauroji, in which, apart from the calorific figure, he does talk of a minimum level of dignified life.
Absolutely.
And I think that, in my view, many components have been left out of this. For instance, I don't think it is meaningful to really have any expenditure on health, which had no relationship to provision for safe drinking water and sanitation, because the absorptive capacity of food, as Amartya Sen has very rightly pointed out in his new book, that the absorptive capacity for nutritional product goes down if there is no access to safe drinking water. And I think that the ability to be able to use protein comes down drastically. So I think it's an advancement. I think it's a progress, but it's not, whether it's good or good enough, in my view, it is not good enough to be able to take as a basis for future planning. Particularly, and none of the two of my panelists have commented on this issue, that on the issue of the entitlement-driven approach to our planning, because after all, these numbers become relevant in terms of who has access to anti-poverty programs and who has access to many of the entitlements which ride on the back of poverty numbers.
No, we will come to that. We will come to the entitlement aspect of it. But as far as you are concerned, you think that a few more parameters need to have been added if this report had to have much more weight. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, sir. Vipul, the basic question. Because, you know, every time we have been having these debates on poverty, you know, it comes down to per capita, per day figures, and, you know, it looks quite ridiculous. And now Mr. Rangarajan's committee has now, you know, increased it to 32 rupees in rural areas and 47 rupees in urban areas. But when you actually put these figures together on a monthly basis per capita, it looks quite decent actually. Now, for instance, Rangarajan committee says that 7,035 per month in urban areas and 4,760 per month in rural areas. So, you know, per capital, family of five. This seems quite reasonable actually. I mean, if you see in urban areas, so you think that this could become the benchmark?
I think these are just numbers. I mean, I'm surprised that there are 93 million new people who are... Right. Where were these people?
They were supposed to be above poverty line.
Above poverty line, they've suddenly become poor.
Right.
Or this is the way we found a new way of looking at the same numbers, as Jadhav Saab said rightly, that you add, first you say that only food items or calorie intake will be calculated. Then you say, okay, a few new parameters. I think this whole business of economics is actually politics.
Absolutely.
And I think we can't leave economics to economists. Because if you leave it to them, they would just keep correcting those little figures here and there and say that this is an improvement on that and that is an improvement on this. My point is that there should be, I agree with Mr. N.K. Singh, that there should be a much more multidimensional and common sense driven approach to measuring poverty. I mean, the Arjun Sengupta report has said that 77% of Indians are below poverty line. People are living in less than 20 rupees per day. The largest number of poor in the world, largest number of malnourished people in this world, largest number of anything, of desperately poor, of destitutes, of uneducated people, and all that. So, I mean, my point is that let's forget the poverty line completely and imagine a new line, and people have already called it empowerment line. You know, do an empowerment line which will be more multidimensional, and don't look at these nitty-gritties of, you know, 2% here, 5% there, and then look at the deprivation and inequality and see that the bottom of the pyramid is actually growing or not.
Actually, Praveen, you know, this is the question. This, what do these figures mean? As Mr. Singh was rightly pointing out, it's all related to entitlement programs.
Absolutely.
The official schemes of the government of India. Otherwise, what does this poverty figures mean at all?
It links with two things. One, you know, what is supposed to be one of the important yardsticks or benchmarks for assessing a government's performance.
Absolutely.
That how many people
you have lifted up above the poverty
or
line.
Not, or otherwise.
And that's more or less a political exercise.
Absolutely.
Which doesn't
nobody
agrees to at
absolutely.
The end of the day.
And second, this issue of entitlement. Now, where many of us have been saying, you know, for years now, that please de-link all these basic services, provisioning of public services to masses at large from any number called poverty incidence. Once you do that, then poverty discussion can, in its own right, serve a very good purpose. You know, it has some substantive intrinsic merit to try and understand how do we think about poverty, etc., etc. But in any case, why do we need to link it with, let's say, giving basic education, basic health services, food, where we know that malnutrition is such a pervasive problem for a country like ours, right? So I think unless we have that delinking, you know, this contentious issue will remain.
Okay,
And second, you know, as we said earlier, that yes, it is a significant advance, but it is certainly not enough. You know, in terms of considering who's poor, who's not poor. For instance, let's say 7,035 per month in urban areas. Try and find a room. It talks of rent, right?
Urban areas,
try and find
all
a
urban
room
areas.
Or a sort of a slum. You know, in any slum in Delhi, you know, one room which can house maybe three or four people will probably cost you 4,000 rupees, right? Now, so clearly, this immediately tells you that there is something seriously inadequate about it, right? The only good thing about it certainly is putting certain other things on the agenda which had disappeared.
Okay. Right? Dr. Jadhav, my question is this. You know, if you don't use this kind of a, you know, this poverty figure, how else are you going to implement the official schemes? You know, official schemes cannot be implemented for everybody. As some people say that for instance, the Food Security Act, they say they don't have any thing, you know, you give it to everybody.
Why don't you
but is it possible?
I mean, you can de-link it from...
My question is this. In your own experience
place.
In the last, last 5 years or more that you've been there, can you de-link?
Not only we can de-link, what I'm trying to say is that we have de-linked in a major way. So, you know, it is no longer linked. Particularly, now, for example, take the food security bill that you talked about.
Right.
66% are going to get.
Right.
It includes BPL as well as APL.
Right.
The connection has long been severed, and we simply do not acknowledge that. Now, in absence of that, what is the alternative in terms of evaluating the schemes? You
exactly.
know, that is something that we need to work out. And while I agree with my co-panelists that we need a much better multidimensional approach, but it's easier said than done.
Exactly.
Otherwise, Noroji is, you know, minimum level of dignified life. How do you quantify that?
Exactly.
You know, when it comes to brass tacks, you have to quantify that. And that is going to be a big challenge. While we have made an advancement, I don't think what Rangarajan committee is saying is ultimate. We can certainly move in
no,
the direction.
But you know, the question is, but Mr. I'll go to Mr. N.K. Singh, but before that, I very quickly.
Sure.
Mr. Singh says that, you know, income-based approach should be doing. You think that will solve some of these problems?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Certainly not.
Which is another way of looking at the same thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you see, again, it is sort of looking at the glass from a different side. That's it.
Okay, Mr. Singh.
I don't think,
Mr. Singh. The question is of, and you know, you were earlier mentioning
yes.
about the official schemes and things like that. These figures are used sometimes to implement the scheme. Sometimes they are not used, like Mr. Jadhav was pointing out about the food security scheme itself. So, how far are these figures useful at all? And what is the alternative?
You
what
see,
is the option?
I think that the use of these figures is. The use of these figures are somewhat limited in my view, but the fact remains that in the ethos of the UPA 1 and UPA 2 government, this issue of targeted beneficiaries
right.
has occupied a high policy priority.
Absolutely.
Namely that if you have access to petroleum and oil products, if you have access to various other kinds of benefits, I think the concept of targeted beneficiaries is directly linked to who are the people who should be entitled, and that is directly linked with how you begin to define the poverty line.
Absolutely.
And the poverty numbers.
Right.
And therefore, I think that I don't agree with Mr. Jadhav that we have moved away from this intended beneficiaries approach. In fact, this is the theme of the 12th five-year plan, which in my view is deeply flawed and would require a fundamental rethink. And I do believe that a somewhat different approach, which is the incomes approach, is not merely looking at it from a different point of view, but I think that because there is an element of dynamic changes inherent, which is also linked to the growing inequality in the economy, it really puts the state and the state apparatus in trying to ensure that the bottom percentile of the population begin to approximate the national mean or the national average over a period of time. So I think that there is progress in this, but I think a lot more needs to be done if it is to be used as an important policy tool and a prescriptive policy tool for government policies and programs.
No, Mr. Singh, my question is that, you know, inequality has grown. Though, and at the same time, it's very curious the way things have happened in the last several years. That, you know, at one level we say that the poverty levels, poverty figures have come down. People below poverty line have come down drastically. You know, when the Tendulkar report came, you know, there was the Planning Commission was talking about, you know, the reduction in nearly 15% in poverty figures. At the same time, the inequality has grown. As Dr. Jadhav was pointing out, many of these you know, solutions which we talk about are much easier said than done. Would you agree with that?
Well, you see, I think the politics of poverty has trumped the economics of poverty.
Absolutely. Right.
So I think that is a big problem because
politics of poverty. No, I was coming. Yes, yes, Vipul, I'll come to you.
Point is very simple. You see, you have been looking at certain numbers. You see the Suresh Tendulkar committee report, and you realize that India has actually done very well vis-a-vis the MDGs.
Last year we were discussing
goals.
How dramatic the fall in poverty has been.
Poverty
and
has
now
fallen,
we are discussing how it has actually not fallen at all.
Exactly.
100 million has been added.
So what you do
excuse
is,
me,
so,
it has
so
fallen.
You,
it
no,
has fallen, but not
sure,
to the extent
sure,
that we
I mean,
thought
whichever,
last year.
Whichever methodology you use, the number of people below poverty line has gone down.
That is fine.
From
I mean, that's a good
so
say if we take 2004,
yeah.
2005
yes.
as the base,
we are talking about this new methodology in the context of these 2 years, in this period, whichever methodology you use,
sure.
the number of people below poverty line has gone down.
No, but
in fact, Rangarajan committee, while it says that 93 million more people are added to the absolute number, they are very clear that the number of people, 92 million people are below poverty line, it has come down. Then 92, whereas Tendulkar had said for the same period, 85 million people have come down.
Sir, the point is very simple. The point is that our development, whatever we've done, has been significant perhaps, but not dramatic. What we need in a country like India, a very dramatic change, because the number of poor, desperately poor people is extremely high. You see, the point is that what I am saying is that if you devise different ways of looking at the same thing, which are more not so metric in approach, which are not driven by numbers, but driven by significant factors, say like exclusion.
Right.
You know, there are, when you look at exclusion, you realize that there are certain categories of people who are excluded, even from the poorest of poor, the ST population, the Scheduled Tribe population of India, Adivasis, the Scheduled Caste, the Dalits of India, women in many ways, and minorities and, you know, Muslims.
I agree.
You see that when you go to that, take that approach, you go move away slightly from the numbers, you would still need to look at the numbers. You would still probably look at something, you know, whether you have improved or not improved.
Right.
But at the same time, exclusion. So we've done all right in population, perhaps. We've done all right in whole lot of other parameters. Hmm. But at the same time, we have, you know, look at unfreedoms. There's so many unfreedoms around us. We look at the freedom. We have the freedom to take bus, but I don't have money in my pocket. This is my unfreedom. Yeah. I can't go to the hospital because I can't pay for it. Mm-hmm. So all these unfreedoms, exclusion, these are the ways of looking at.
Yes, I completely agree with Vipul. The point that I want to make is that in respect of what Mr. Singh was saying, while the government so far, he is absolutely right that there has been a greater accent on targeted beneficiaries, no doubt about it. What I want to add is that the targeted beneficiaries approach is not exclusively based on the people above or below poverty line. There are, in fact, a set of 8 different indicators based on exclusion, exactly what Vipul was talking about, and that the targeting is done in terms of those and not on the poverty line
basis. Not based on this poverty line.
So that cannot be the criticism of the poverty line.
No. 3 quick points. I mean, this targeting started not with UPA1, but it goes back to mid-90s, 94, so to say. Number 2, there has been some delinking as regards poverty numbers and provisioning in some schemes, you know, some entitlements and so on. Food was one example.
Sure.
Number 3, however, you know, these numbers still do not convince me as regards whether we should take these as a poverty line number, right? I think the kind of deprivation which we see all around us, you know, so if we go by that, so whether it is World Bank's $1.25 or, you know, if all these numbers, just looking around us, are seriously suspect, right? So certainly some advance, but this is something, you know, which is again, in my assessment and maybe my fellow panelists' assessments as well, seriously inadequate also, you know, in terms of what should be the benchmark, both in terms of what you can access and the various kinds of unfreedoms and freedoms that Vipul is talking about.
Mr. N.K. Singh, you spoke about politics of poverty, you know, overtaking the politics of poverty of economics. Anyway, all this is fine, but the final question is that, you know, how should the present government approach this report, and, you know, what is going to be the, what do you think should be the approach, and you think that Rangarajan committee's figures will make any major difference to as far as policies of this present government is concerned?
Let me put it this way to you, that I think I entirely agree with Vipul's last comments that, you know, you begin to take, for instance, the World Bank 1.25, the Asian Development Bank has instead suggested 1.50. You can go on calibrating these figures, and depending on where you finally settle,
right,
you'll find the number of people who have crossed the poverty line either increasing or decreasing. So I think I regard that kind of an approach as having a very limited use. And the approach on this whole area of exclusion and inclusion, who is left out on various parameters of inclusion in terms of the usual development matrix and so on and so forth. I think that this report of Rangarajan requires a much deeper debate. It requires, I think, much deeper consultations. And I think, in my view, that is an approach which any new review of the 12th five-year plan would necessarily have to encounter the issue of targeted beneficiaries. The best and most efficacious way of delivering the targeted subsidies, whether in terms of direct cash benefit and to whom the direct cash benefit should go. I mean, those are the kind of policy issues which have been left unsettled, notwithstanding the Rangarajan committee report, which I think that whatever changes have been effected, in my view, are not good enough to address some of the issues which have been raised in this panel itself.
Okay. I think on that note, we need to end. But, you know, this is a debate which has to go on, as Mr. N.K. Singh says. This whole debate on poverty has renewed, and, you know, on the basis of what Rangarajan has said, there will be much more discussions and debate. We also hope to look at it after some time. Once the government takes a view on this, we will wait and watch what the government will have to say on this. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. N.K. Singh, Praveen Jha, Narendra Jadhav and Vipul Mudgal. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue in the big picture, same time tomorrow.